circumstances, so that you know, it's been a, you know, an ongoing process of identifying where our roster is strong, where it's, where it could use you know, some additional roster moves. I think the we still have a need to add a couple pitchers at this point, you know, given the schedule is you know, very aggressive, you know, 55 games in 10 weeks, you know, basically, you know, one off day a week, the way it works. And you know, we want to be very careful that, you know, we don't overload, you know, the pitching staff. And I think that, you know, that's something that the league is concerned about as well.
Now, the Futures Collegiate Baseball League, they're in their second year of existence this year. And I wanted you to go more into detail about what's the differences and the similarities to the Cape League, which has been around for a while.
Certainly, and Scott, as you know, having spent a season with another summer collegiate team, you know, a couple seasons ago, the you know, I think New England is a hotbed of you know, summer collegiate baseball, with Cape Cod being the you know, the premium league in the country. You know, if you get invited to play on the Cape, that means you're a legitimate prospect. You know, you'll see probably a number of players in the upcoming you know, major league entry draft that are drafted, who are had played the prior season on the Cape or will be playing this you know, summer on the Cape. It is by far the premium league. You know, anyone who's seen the movie Summer Catch, you know, if not, I recommend it. You know, profiles the Cape League and the you know, the great job they do. And you know, our league is we're trying to establish it as the one level below the Cape in terms of, you know, the way we run our operations and the quality of the players, you know, with an emphasis on the New England player. And you know, we've, with all the great programs in New England, and I think sometimes the New England player gets overlooked in you know, in the summer collegiate leagues, and until we formed our league, and we just had the Wheaton College you know, program compete in the Division III Collegiate World Series and finishes runners up, you know, losing the championship game out in Appleton, Wisconsin, and just, you know, shows the quality of baseball that at all levels we see here in New England. The, I think the, you know, our teams are required to have half of our roster be represented by kids from New England or with affiliations to New England schools, and I think that's a commitment to the New England player that you know, we made as part of our charter.
Now, I know a lot of fans out there and viewers are probably wondering, is this a wooden bat league or aluminum?
This is wooden bat for sure, like all the summer collegiate leagues tend to be. And the purpose of you know, the summer collegiate leagues is to give, you know, players a chance to show what they can do with a wooden bat. And you know, we're hoping that eventually, you know, more of the college programs will move to, you know, the tradition of a wooden bat, which I think, you know, many fans would like to see. You know, we certainly, you know, I personally like the you know, the sound of the ball coming off a wooden bat than the ping of a metal bat. And I think there's a couple conferences in the Northeast that are exclusively wooden bat at the Division II level. And you know, it'll be interesting to see how those players coming from a collegiate program using wooden bats do, and how the ones coming from a metal bat, you know, how they adjust to playing with a wooden bat. I know the, you know, the area scouts that will attend, you know, some of the games will be, you know, monitoring some of that as well.
How do you feel about the team getting together for the first time this week? Do you think they're able to gel well? I know you talked about having the junior college coach. I think that will help a lot. Was that one of the main reasons why you went that way with the coach?
No, I think it was when I talked to Mike and just understood his, got to understand his philosophy towards the summer collegiate experience, that, and we all understand that, you know, these players, particularly, you know, the D1 players, you know, have a, you know, a lot of pressure in the spring, and you know, it's a chance for the players to, you know, have a little bit more relaxed environment and let their natural talent come out. And I think Mike understands that. And the it's an opportunity. It's both a development league, you know, chance for players to develop their skills, and a chance to, you know, compete playing the game they love to play, and you know, do it in a way that you know, is a little more, you know, a little less intense than, you know, what the college programs bring to the table.
We're looking forward to them playing on Friday night. You talked about Doyle Field and how 5 years ago or so, they didn't think the field was ready. Can you talk about some of the renovations? I know people in the area, I'm sure, know all about that there have been renovations going on, but can you talk in detail about the different renovations that have been done?
Yeah, Ross, absolutely. You know, we've been able to accomplish a tremendous amount over there, starting with the work to completely replace the infield with the right mix of clay and sand so that it drains well, and it gives us a foundation to put down a quality sod that will represent an infield the way it needs to for a collegiate level of play, and then and regrading the pitching mound and putting in a pitching mound that's going to hold up over the course of the season. And then one of the requirements of the league was that we have enclosed dugouts, and as soon as we identified that as a requirement, the Doyle Field Foundation saw that as an opportunity to accelerate their vision for the upper field to complement the great work that was done on the football field and the work, and said, if we're going to do enclosed dugouts, let's make sure we're using the some of the same architectural and design work that we used on the football field with the special Vermont brick and the and some of the granite features, and they got behind that. The foundation, matched my contribution to get the thing started, and then a number of private contractors contributed time and materials to see the dugouts, the vision for the dugouts completed. We've had to put in new fencing to reline some of the fence lines and upgrade that, and there's still some things we've like to see done. Eventually, I think the foundation would like to see a grandstand behind home plate, and that's probably a few years, and maybe a park and recreation grant away from getting that done. But there's an abandoned rail line behind Doyle Field that I think the cities of Fitchburg and Leominster have a vision for maybe that being a rail trail that connects the two cities at some point and could add some additional space behind home plate to put in a grandstand. And I think there's a vision there that the foundation and the architectural firm that has helped the foundation for that area, and I think it would be great to see that foundation, that vision come to fruition over the next few years.
Yeah, our viewers got a view of the dugout while you're talking with them. They look absolutely great. Thank you for coming on the show, and thank you for giving us your time.
Yeah, excellent, Ross and Scott. And
thank you so much.
Looking forward to building this, all the activity leading up to opening day, so it should be a lot of fun.
Our baseball camp, once again, is going to be running the week of June 25th, on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, from 9 a.m. to 11:15 a.m. And we also will run that as well on July 9th. Also, we do have a team store. If you go to our website at www.dirtdogsball.com and click on shop, you'll be able to shop at our team store. Now, every week, we will have a trivia contest. And at the end of the show, this is our first one of the year. And you will be getting a pair of tickets for the first person to respond correctly. It's a pair of tickets to a future home game throughout the summer. Now, to submit your answer, go to our website, www.dirtdogsball.com, and click on Outside the Doghouse. At the top of the page, simply fill out the form and click submit. Here is today's question. Including the Dirt Dawgs, how many teams are in the Futures Collegiate Baseball League? And I'll repeat that one more time. Including the Dirt Dawgs, how many teams are in the Futures Collegiate Baseball League? Once again, you can go to the website at www.dirtdogsball.com and you may enter there.
Don't forget to follow us on Twitter at @dawg_pen and to like our Facebook page to stay up to date with the latest news of the Wachusett Dirt Dawgs. And you can purchase our tickets, day-to-day tickets. You can purchase right now, walk up, you can purchase them at the field on game nights. The schedule is on our website, and you can also purchase season tickets on our website.
This show will be aired weekly throughout the whole summer. For Ross and Scott, thank you very much for watching today, and we hope to see you next week.